الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. Last week we finished a madkhal to aqidah. We finished an introduction to aqidah, an overview to aqidah, alhamdulillah. And we also took the most prominent firaq groups. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to start a subject which we call تدوين السنة النبوية. This subject, calling it تدوين السنة النبوية, is نوع من التساهل. This is what a lot of people have already probably heard. تدوين السنة النبوية, right? But this term, تدوين, who can help me with a good translation? Record. Huh? If tadween is writing, then what's tasnif? There's a farq between the two. Okay, I'll explain it then. If we can't find translation for it, we explain it. You see, this is vital that you understand this point, inshallah ta'ala. At the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it was the era of at-talaqi, in which the Sahabas were taking it from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It was the era of taking in. Sahabas were just memorizing. They were narrating, they were hearing it from the Prophet. And it was also the era of riwayah, narration. That's the first generation, the first ahdul awwal, the first era. It was the era of at-talaqi, taking from the Prophet and then narrating. Are we all together? Then came the second era, which is at-tadween. Tadween is to record, document. Okay? And we'll study that more, inshallah ta'ala, and we'll explain that more, bi-idhnillah al-kareem. Number three was the era of at-tasnif, authorship. It was the era of what? The era of tasnif. Tasnif means what? Authorship. Books were being written. Scholars were coming out. Muhammad ibn Shihab al-Zuhri came with the command of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, then Ma'mar ibn Rashid, and Al-Awza'i, and Malik ibn Anas, and the likes of these people. Are you with me, brothers? This was the era when books were written. And then within the authorship, the tasnif was not all the same. The authorship was not all the same. Some of them, they just wrote and authored a book in ahkam. Some of them authored a book in authenticity, like Al-Imam al-Bukhari and Al-Imam al-Muslim and Ibn Khuzaymah and Ibn Hibban and Hakim. They condition authenticity. So we'll study all of that, inshallah ta'ala. So this subject, Tadween al-Sunnah, to call it Tadween al-Sunnah, it seems like the person's only going to speak about what? That they're only going to speak about this era. But we're actually going to be talking about this time and this time as well. Does everyone understand this point? That this was the time, this is Ahdul Awal, the first era, and this is Ahdul Thani, and this is the ending of the second generation until what? And after that. إِلَى يَوْمِنَا هَذَا till today, works have been written, books have been written. Are we all together? So from the second, the ending of the second generation to the third and the fourth and the fifth and the sixth and the seventh and the eighth and the ninth, which will be taken inshallah ta'ala, all of that was the time of a tasnif, authorship. Does that make sense? Does everyone understand here? This subject is very, very important. Very vital. Extremely important. Especially looking at a lot of you, you're from the subcontinent, India. And I was honored to have gone to India and visited. In India, there is a group who believe that we only take the what? The Quran. And they reject the what? They reject the Sunnah. The Sunnah doesn't mean anything to them. We'll only stick to the Quran. And zuran wa buhtanan wa tadlilan. They call themselves Quraniyun. They shouldn't be called Quraniyun. Because a Qurani is a person who follows the Sunnah as well. Because the Quran instructs you to follow the Sunnah, as we're going to see today. What they should be called is Munkiri as-Sunnah, the rejecters of the Sunnah. This subject, after studying it, learning it, you'll understand a lot. We'll be tackling their issues, where they went wrong, where this problem came from, and 99.9% of those people who reject the Sunnah have never probably studied what we're going to study today. Okay? So for you today, when this class starts, inshallah ta'ala, give your heart and mind to it, inshallah ta'ala. But we're going to start with today, two things, inshallah ta'ala, today's class. Today's class, we're going to focus on what? Today's class, we're going to focus on two things. Makanatu sunnah fil Islam. What position does the sunnah hold in our religion? What's the weight? What is the position of the sunnah in Islam? Are you with me, brothers? When I speak about that, I will speak about it from, I'm going to prove the position of the sunnah from three places. Okay? The position that the sunnah holds, I'm going to prove it from three places, inshallah ta'ala. The first one is what? Al-Qur'an. I'm going to, and we're all going to look at what does the Qur'an say about the Sunnah. Okay? Number two, I'm going to take the Sunnah itself. What does the Sunnah say regarding the Sunnah? And then number three, Aqwalu Salaf. The statement of the pious predecessors. When I say Salaf here, who do I mean? The Sahabas and the Tabi'een and the Tabi'ut Tabi'een. The three golden generation. What they said about the Sunnah. After I finish that, I'm going to go into the next point, inshallah ta'ala, which is inayatu Salafi biha. The importance, the dedication that the Salaf gave to the Sunnah. Inaya means the importance, the dedication, the passion, the love that the Salaf had towards the Sunnah. Are we all together? When I say Salaf here, I only mean two, inshallah ta'ala. The first one are who? As-Sahaba. I will prove how the Sahabas looked at the Sunnah. Are you with me, brothers? And how they valued the Sunnah. That's number one. When I say Salaf here, I mean As-Sahaba. How am I going to look at the way that the Sahabas valued the Sunnah? In what way? Is ittiba'uhum biha, how they followed it. ittiba'un biha, how the salaf followed, how the sahabas followed it. I'm going to go show you some examples of how the sahabas, they followed the sunnah. No ifs, no buts, no questions. They followed it straight away. That's the first way I'm going to prove it. The second way I'm going to prove it is how they had at-tahari wa-tathabbut. How the sahabas, they were diligent, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum, in what they were narrating from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. At-tahari wa-tathabbut fima yarunahu, that which the companions were narrating, they were diligent. They would make sure the Prophet did say this. That's how important the sunnah was to the sahabas. Let me repeat that one more time. Today's lesson is going to be about makanatu sunnati fil Islam, the position that the sunnah has in Islam. I'm going to bring ayat from the Quran. I'm going to bring, inshallah ta'ala, ahadiths. I'm also going to bring aqwalu salaf, the statements of the pious predecessors. Once I speak about that and I finish, I'm going to move on to the second point of today's lesson, which is what? Inayatu salafi biha. The importance that the salaf gave to what? Biha ay sunnah, to the sunnah. This pronoun ha goes back to the sunnah. The importance that they gave the sunnah. Good. How are you going to do that? I'm going to prove it. When I said salafiyah, I'm referring to who? As-sahaba, the companions here. But which way did the sahabas give importance to the sunnah? By following it. I'm going to bring examples of that, inshallah ta'ala. Number two, at-tahari wa-tathabbut fi ma yarunahu. How they were diligent and they were careful in when they spoke about the Prophet ﷺ. This is an indication of how they respected the sunnah and how important it was to them. Inshallah ta'ala. I'm going to then speak about number two. Second people I'm talking about when I say salaf is who? At-tabi'een. The tabi'een. How am I going to prove the way that the tabi'een gave importance to the sunnah? In four ways, inshallah ta'ala. Number one, بِحِفْظِهَا, how they memorized it. I'm going to bring examples of how the tabi'een memorized the ahadith and they gave importance to memorizing it. Number two, السؤال عن الإسنادي, how they asked about the chain of narration. They wanted to know the chain. Who narrated it from who? Who did you hear it from? Who heard it from who? This was their way of giving importance to the sunnah. Number three, al-bahth fi ahwal al-rijali wa naqalat al-akhbar. How they researched, after the chain was given to them, they researched every individual. Where was he born? Who did he take from? Where did he go? Where did he not go? How did he go there? About his biography in details. And the fourth way is tadween as-sunnah. How they documented the sunnah for us. And they put it into works. The fourth one is tadween as-sunnah. These four steps, it will be an indication of how the tabi'een, they respected and they gave importance to the sunnah. Number one is inayatu bihifdhiha. They gave memorization to keep the sunnah in their head. That's how they respected and that's how much they loved it. As-su'al anil isnad. How they would ask about the chain. Okay, what's the chain? Who did you hear it from? because you never met the Prophet. So who did you hear it from? Heard it from Fulan. Hey, who did Fulan hear it from? Fulan. Who did he hear it from? Fulan. Who did he hear it from? The Prophet. Good. Now that they've been given the Senate, what did they do? Al-Bahthu fi ahwal al-rijal wa naqat al-akhbar. Okay, who's Fulan? What's his full name? Where does he live? Where was he born? Where did he die? And they went and they found out his biography inside out. Verified. Number four, whatever information that they gathered now, they done tadween of it. They recorded it for us. Are you with me, brothers? This was the way that the tabi'een were giving importance to the sunnah. Today, inshallah ta'ala, I will try my best, bi'aunillahi wa madadi, to cover all of those points, inshallah ta'ala. Let's start with the first part, which is the position that the sunnah holds. Let's take ayat from the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in the Quran, the first ayah that shows the position that the sunnah holds is the ayah number 3 to ayah number 4, Surah An-Najm. Ayah 3 to ayah 4, Surah An-Najm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he does not speak from his whims and desires. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ. Nabiullah Muhammad does not talk from his own whims and desires. This is not his own personal desires. No. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. It's a revelation from Allah. Pay attention to this point. The Quran is a revelation from Allah. And the Sunnah is a what? It's a revelation from Allah. وَلِذَلِكْ حَافِظَ الْحَكَمِيُّ. He says in his Lu'lu' al-Maknun, he says, فَالسُنَّةُ النَّبِيِّ وَحْيٌ ثَانٍ عَلَيْهِمَا قَدْ أُطْلِقَ الْوَحْيَانِ وَإِنَّمَا طَرِيقُهَا الرِّوَايَةِ فَافْتَقَرَ الرَّاوِي إِلَى الدِّرَايَةِ بِصِحَّةِ الْمَرْوِيَّ عَنْ رَسُولِ لِيُعْلَمَ الْمَرْدُودُ مِنْ مَقْبُولِ لا سيما عند التظاهر الفتن ولبس إفك المحدثين بالسنن. He said that the sunnah is the second revelation. فسنة النبي وحي ثاني. That the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is a what? It's the second revelation. Both of them are called what? Wahy. That's why, based on what ayah? وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. That's the first evidence that the sunnah is a what? It's a revelation. The second evidence from the Qur'an is وَأَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَىٰ. This is Surah An-Nahl, Ayah 44. Surah An-Nahl, Ayah 44. Surah An-Nahl, Ayah 44. Allah says, وَأَنْزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. Muhammad, we have sent down on you a dhikra. What's the dhikr here? The Quran and the Sunnah. لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, so you can clarify for the people. مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ, the revelation that was sent to them. Some of the scholars, they said the dhikr here means the sunnah specifically. Why? Because after Allah mentioned the Quran, he said, we sent the sunnah down unto you, Muhammad, so you can clarify to the people the Quran in which they need. Ayah 44, Surah An-Nahl. Sahih? Huh? How anzalna ilayka dhikra. That last part of the ayah. Wa anzalna ilayka dhikra litubayyana lin-nasi ma nuzila ilayhim wa la'allahum yatafakkarun. Pay attention here. So the Sunnah came down to what? Clarify and explain the what? The Quran. Put a line here, or a dot, or a mark on your note, because I'm going to bring you the kalam of Ibn Abdul Barr in his kitab Jami' Bayan al-Ilmi wa Fadli. How does the Sunnah explain the Quran? Okay? This is beneficial. The statement of Ibn Abdul Barr is going to be gold. I'm going to mention it later, inshallah ta'ala. So, it's best that I bring, you write it under this ayah, okay? That you write it under this ayah. But for me, I don't want to do that because I'm going according to a sequence. I'm going according to what I wrote on the board. The third evidence. The third what? Evidence of the position that the Sunnah holds is the ayah 7, Surah Al-Hashr. Ayah 7, Surah Al-Hashr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا. وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ, what does it mean? Some people's translation is, whatever the Prophet comes with, take it. Correct? Incorrect. Anyone who says, whatever the Prophet came with, take it, is wrong. And that is an incorrect translation of the verse. That person cannot distinguish between atakum and atakum. And they totally mean different. One is fi'l lazim and one is fi'l muta'addi. One is a transitive verb and one is an intransitive verb. The correct meaning is, if the Prophet gives you something, take it from him. If he gives you something, take it from him. And if he prohibits you from something, stay away from it. If he gives you something, take it from him. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Are you with me, brothers? And if he prohibits you from something, stay away from it. I mentioned three, right? Fourth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, the fourth one is Surah Ali Imran, ayah 31. Surah Ali Imran, ayah 31. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, قُلْ, say to them, Muhammad, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ, if you love Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, follow me, يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهَ, Allah will love you, وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ, وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Say to them, Muhammad, إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ, if you love Allah, if your love for Allah is real, and it's not a mere claim, if it's not just a claim, but it's real, you really love Allah, as you say, the thing to really tell us that it's true, this claim of yours is true, is what? The following of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَلِذَٰلِكَ حَسَنَ الْبَصْرِي, what did he say? He said when it came to this ayah, اِدَّعَ قَوْمٌ مَحَبَّةَ اللَّهِ, a group of people, they claim the love of Allah. فَبَتَلَاهُمُ اللَّهُ بِهَذِي الْآيَةِ, Allah tested them with this ayah. That's why scholars, they call this ayah آيَةُ الْإِمْتِحَانِ, the verse of test. To test what? If your love for Allah is true. Sah. Is to see if your love for Allah is really true. Because everybody can say, I love Allah. Wallahi, I love Allah. I love Allah. Everyone can say that. Sah. Da'awa, ma lam tuqimu bi bayinatin abna'uha adi'iyah. Claiming is the easiest thing. Everyone can do that. But making your claim into reality, showing it, the way that you talk, the way that you act, the way that you carry yourself, your belief, everything is in accordance to the Prophet, your love for Allah is true. You do really love Allah. So this ayah, what does it show us? The ones who say, Wallahi, we love the Quran. but they don't follow the Prophet. What do we say? Do they love the Quran? That's why we don't call them Quraniyun. Are you with me, brothers? Your claim for the Quran, which is the speech of Allah, is what? Null and void. It's not true. Because the way to know that you really love the Quran is to follow the Prophet. Are you with me? The fifth evidence, Surah An-Nisa, ayah 65. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Allah says, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. They are not true believers. They are not true believers. حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. That when they have disputes, and they have arguments, and conflicts, if they don't make you their judgment. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if these people, when they have conflicts, two people are fighting, wife and a husband, two friends, two individuals in the same company, they are going at each other. If they don't take it back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah said they're not true believers. And when they take it to the Prophet, and the judgment is brought to the Prophet, and the result comes, the result is given, ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ. In their heart, they don't have enmity towards that ruling. They're happy. Did Allah say that? Did the Messenger say that? Oh Allah, surrender. They give in. They surrender. And they are happy. So how many things is needed? Three things. To really know if you have true iman. Number one, when something happens in your life, if you have a conflict with somebody, if you have a problem with somebody, you bring it back to who? The Prophet ﷺ, number one. Bringing it back to the Sunnah, one. Second is to what? فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا. Surrender. When the result and the answer and the judgment that's given is told to you, you're wrong. Surrender. Say, I am wrong. Number three, be happy. Don't just surrender, but be pleased with it. Why? Because this came from who? Allah Azza wa Jalla. وَلَا يُنَبِّئُكَ مِثْلُ خَبِيرٌ وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا وَتَمَّتْ كَلِمَةُ رَبِّكَ صِدْقًا وَعَدْلًا. This came from Allah, and Allah is just. Be happy. Surrender. Don't ask why, me, who. Don't say that. Just surrender. Are you with me, brothers? The last evidence from the ayat, from the Quran, is Surah An-Nur. Surah An-Nur. Ayah 63. Ayah 63, Surah An-Nur. Allah says, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً أَوْ يُصِيبَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Allah says, فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ. Let them be cautious. فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ. Let them be very cautious. And warned. Who? الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِهِ. The ones that are going against the Prophet's way. فَلْيَحْذَرْ. Be cautious. Be what? Be cautious. What's going to happen to you? Of what? فَلْيَحْذَرِ الَّذِينَ يُخَالِفُونَ عَنْ أَمْرِ أَنْ تُصِيبَهُمْ فِتْنَةً. Fitna is going to happen to you. Are you doing, brothers? What are you scared of? What are you worried about? Fitna is going to happen to you. Do you know what Imam Ahmed said that the fitna here means? Imam Ahmed said that the fitna in this ayah means that you went against the Prophet's command and you rejected it once, that it's going to become your path to apostasy. Ridda. Ahmed said fitna here means ridda, apostasy. Because one time, if you reject the Prophet, what's preventing you from rejecting him 20 times? What is stopping you from rejecting him 100 times? What is stopping you from rejecting him in totality? Are you with me, brothers? وَلِذَلِكَ if the person takes going against the Prophet once lightly, it won't stop there. It will carry on and it will carry on and it will carry on until it becomes 100. That's why Imam Ahmad said, the ones who go against the Prophet's command in this ayah, the fitna that is scared for them, that they need to be cautious of, is الرِّدَّ عَنْ دِينِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ, apostasy from the religion. Are you with me, brothers? May Allah protect us from apostasy. Now we're going to go into the ahadith. Now we're going to go into the ahadith. How many evidences from the Quran did I give you? How much did I give? اختلف العلماء. Some are saying 5. Is that ijma'? We need the ijma'. To take it serious, we need to take ijma', sah? We don't want khilaf. How many?
6.
Final? 6. Now we're going to go into the sunnah. The sunnah is hadith Ubaydullah ibn Abi Rafi'in, who narrated from his father Abi Rafi'. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, this hadith is narrated by Imam Abi Dawood in his Sunan. And Imam Abi Dawood, in his Sunan, he has a chapter called Babu Luzum Sunnah, holding on to the Sunnah. And Imam Abi Dawood in his Sunan, which is a hadith book, inside there, there's a chapter where he called it sticking to, holding on to the Sunnah. In there, he brings this hadith. That the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, alayhi salatu wa sallam, لَأَلْفَيَنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ مُتَّكِئًا عَلَىٰ أَرِيكَتِهِ يَأْتِيهِ الْأَمْرُ مِنْ أَمْرِي مِمَّا أَمَرْتُ بِهِ أَوْ نَهَيْتُ عَنْهُ فَيَقُولُ لَا نَدْرِي مَا وَجَدْنَا فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ اتَّبَعْنَاهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, alayhi salatu, pay attention to this, لَأَلْفَيَنَّ, that there's going to be a person who is inclining, or he's resting on his what? On a pillow or a sofa. He's lying down. He's relaxed. مُتَّكِئًا عَلَىٰ أَرِيكَتِي يَأْتِيهِ الْأَمْرُ مِنْ أَمْرِي. A matter will come to him from my matters, meaning from the Sunnah. It will be told to him that the Prophet said this. He commanded this. Mimma amartu bi, something I commanded will be told to him. Aw nahaytu anhu, or something I prohibited will be told to this person. Fayaqulu, this person will say, la nadri, we don't know this. We don't know this sunnah. We don't know this sunnah. Ma wajadna fi kitabillahi tab'ana. Whatever we find in the kitab of Allah, we will take. As for the Sunnah, we don't know this stuff. Bukhari, where did he come? Bukhari came 250 after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Are you with me, brothers? Hadiths, when were they collected? Who collected them? We don't know this. But little do they know, the way that the hadith came through changed, so did the Quran. The Qur'an came through asanid and riwayat and through chains. Are you with me, brothers? So the Prophet already told us that there are going to be a people who are going to reject what? His sunnah. And he even told us what they're going to say. That they're going to say, فَيَقُولُ, he will say, لَا نَدْرِ, we don't know this. This concept, I want you to brothers to know this, which is, a lot of people, when they say to you, I don't know this, they think, or they make it seem like, because they don't know it, it doesn't exist. So you ask him a question, you say, brother, did the Prophet ﷺ say this? And he will say to you, I've never heard of this. Are you with me, brothers? So when you hear that from him, what do you think? That he doesn't exist. And the qa'idah is adam al-wujud la yadullu ala adam al-wujdan. Just because you couldn't find it, because you didn't come across it, it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. Are you with me, brothers? Just because you don't know, doesn't mean it doesn't exist. So that's why a lot of the times, if you say to somebody, I haven't come across this, always add, and it may be there. It could be. I will research. Are you with me, brothers? Especially if you've only read 40 hadith by Imam al-Nawawi. And you haven't finished the Quran. Are you with me, brothers? What you have and what is missing from you, which was more? Yeah, what is more? You already have 42 hadiths. You probably didn't do just amma tafsir. All of it. And then when you ask the question, you're like, the messenger never said this. You give a definite rejection. Sahih? This is a problem. وَلِذَٰلِكَ Imam Muhammad ibn Shahab al-Zuhri, a man, he said to a man once in a gathering, Ibn Shahab said that the Prophet didn't say this. And you know Ibn Shahab al-Zuhri is from there? He's from the shuyukh of Imam Malik. He's Imam Malik's teacher. Muhammad ibn Shahab al-Zuhri. And he met the Sahabas. Are you with me, brothers? So he said that the Prophet didn't say this. And so a man said, did you read all of the hadith of the Prophet? And Muhammad ibn Shahab al-Zuhri said, no. No one can claim on the face of this earth that they came across all the hadith of the Prophet. And Imam al-Shafi'i, we said in his kitab, Jumma'ul Ilm, anyone who says, I memorized all the hadith of the Prophet is a liar. No one did. The Quran, yes. Lakin the hadith and the sunnah, it's too much. No one can do ihata. Are you with me, brothers? Even at this time when all the hadith are present, you just have to look it up. How many times do we find mashayikh who said, وَلَمْ أَقِفْ عَلَى هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ, I never came across this hadith. Are you with me, brothers? So when Ibn Shahab al-Zuhri said, the Prophet didn't say this. He said, the Prophet didn't say this. The man said to him, did you read all the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ? Muhammad ibn Shahab said, no. He said, did you read half of the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ? He said, no. He said, one third of it. Ibn Shahab said, no. He said, how do you say that the Prophet ﷺ didn't say this? That's Imam Malik's teacher. So when somebody asks you a question and you don't know this issue, the best thing to say is, first of all, Allahu A'lam. And the second thing is, say, I didn't come across it and it may be possible that it's out there. But we will look into it more, inshallah ta'ala. But we'll come to that point, inshallah ta'ala, later when we speak about at-tahari wa at-tathabbutu fi ma yarunahu. This, we'll speak about it more in details. The second evidence is the hadith of Al-Miqdad ibn Ma'di Karab, the companion. Al-Miqdad ibn Ma'di Karabin, عن رسول الله, from the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, that the messenger said, ألا إني أوتيت القرآن ومثله معه. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, ألا, O people, أوتيت القرآن ومثله معه, I was given the Quran and like the Quran. The Sahabi who narrated this is who? Maqdad ibn Ma'di Karab. And it's found in Sunnah Abi Dawood, the chapter I told you, Babul Uzum Sunnah. That the Prophet said, Ala, O people, Inni utitul Qur'an, I was given the Quran, wa mithlahu, and like it I was given. What does he mean, like it? Sunnah. He means Sunnah. Now I'm going to go into the statement of the Salaf. The Salaf, what they said. What did the Salaf say regarding the Sunnah? Hassan al-Basri, Imam Hassan al-Basri, he said, "Anna Imran ibn Husayn." Who's Imran ibn Husayn? A companion. Are you with me, brothers? Hassan al-Basri said that Imran ibn Husayn كان جالسا ومعه أصحابه. Imran ibn Husayn was sitting one day, this noble companion was sitting one day, and his students were around him. His students were around him, Imran ibn Husayn. فقال رجل من القوم. Imran ibn Husayn was talking to his students and he was discussing with them. And what was he doing? He was bringing a hadith. For whatever issue he was talking about, he'll bring hadith for it. So a man said in the gathering to this companion, Imran ibn Husayn, he said to him, لا تحدثونا إلا بالقرآن. Don't tell us except the Quran. Don't talk to us except with the Quran. That's all we want. Don't tell us except the Quran. فقال Imran Hussein said to the man, Udlu, come close. Come close to me. So he seemed the man was a bit far. So he said to him, come close to me. فَدَنَا الرَّجُلُ The man came close to Hassan, Imran ibn Husayn. فَقَالَ He said to him, أَرَأَيْتَ لَوْ كِلْتَ أَنْتَ وَأَصْحَابُكَ إِلَى الْقُرْآنِ He said, if this matter regarding the Qur'an was placed in your hands and it was given to you, meaning since you're the, you know what, the sunnah, if the Qur'an and its affairs were given to you and you were told to speak, okay, and to use your Qur'an only, أَكُنْتَ تَجِدُ فِي صَلَاةِ الظُّهْرِ أَرْبَعًا Would you find in that Qur'an that you have, dhuhr is four, وَصَلَاةُ الْعَصْرِ وَصَلَاةَ الْعَصْرِ And that salat al-asr is what? Arba'an, four. وَالْمَغْرِبَ Salatan, and that maghrib is three. Would you have found it there? Would you find all of that in there? Then he went on to say, أَرَأَيْتَ لَوْ كِلْتَ أَنْتَ وَأَصْحَابُكَ إِلَى الْقُرْآنِ أَكُنْتَ تَجِدُ الطَّوَافَ بِالْبَيْتِ سَبْعًا Would you have found that going around and circumambulating around the Kaaba seven times, would you have found this in the Quran? وَالطَّوَافَ بِالسَّعِي بِالسَّفَى وَالْمَرْوِ أَمَا السَّعِي بَيْنَ السَّفَى وَالْمَرْوِ To go between Safa and Marwa seven times. All the Quran mentions is what? إِنَّ السَّفَى وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ It doesn't mention seven. The Sunnah mentions the seven. Would you have found that in the Quran? ثُمَّ قَالَ And then he said to him, أي قوم Imran ibn Husayn said to the people who were sitting there, people خذوا عنا take from us فإنكم والله إن لم تفعلوا أما إن لم تفعلوا لتضلن Imran ibn Husayn he said to him, oh people take from us If you don't, you will truly be misguided. Meaning, take from us the sunnah that we give to you. Take it from us. Oh, wallahi, you'll be misguided. And Imam Khatib al-Baghdadi narrated this in his kitab al-Kifaya, fi ilm al-Riwayah. The second is Muhammad ibn Kathir, he narrated from Al-Awza'i. That Awza'i narrated from who? Hassan ibn Atiyah, Imam Ahl al-Sham. Al-Imam Al-Awza'i narrated from Hassan ibn Atiyah. That Hassan ibn Atiyah said, Kana Jibreel was ينزل على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بالسنة. Jibreel used to come down. Jibreel would what? Used to come down on the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم with the Sunnah. كما ينزل عليه بالقرآن. The way that he used to come to him on the what? On the Quran. The way that Jibreel would come down with the Quran, he said he would come down on the Sunnah. That's what he said. وَيُعَلِّمُهُ إِيَّاهَا, and he would teach him it, كَمَا يُعَلِّمُهُ الْقُرْآنَ, he would teach the Prophet, the Sunnah, the way he would teach him the Qur'an. Are you with me, brothers? Al-Imam al-Darimi narrated that in his Sunan. Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani, he said, أَنَّ رَجُّلًا قَالَ لِمُطَرِّفِ بْنَ عَبْدِ اللَّهِ بْنُ الشَّخِيرِ, a man said to Mutarrif ibn Abdullah al-Shakhir. Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani is narrating this, that a man said to Mutarrif ibn Abdullah al-Shakhir, a man said to him, لا تحدثون إلا بالقرآن, don't tell us anything except the Quran. And then Mutarrif said to him, والله ما نريد بالقرآن بدلا ولكن نريد من هو أعلم بالقرآن منا. Mutarrif ibn Abdullah al-Shakhir, a man said to him, don't tell us anything except the Quran. We don't want the Sunnah. The only thing that we want is the what? The Quran. And then Mutarrif said to him, Wallahi, ma nuridu bil Quran badalan. We don't want anything to take the place of the Quran. We don't want to exchange anything with the Quran. Even we don't want to. But what we want is, walakin nuridu. But what we want is, one who knows the Quran more than us. Who knows the Quran more than us? The Sunnah. So the Sunnah is not here to exchange the Quran. It's actually here to what? Explain the Quran. And this is what they fall into, those who want to reject the Sunnah. They believe that the Sunnah is what? It's coming to remove the Quran. But rather what it's doing is it's explaining the Quran. And that concept is not there with them. Ayyub al-Sakhtiyani, he said, إِذَا حَدَّثْتَ الرَّجُلَ, if you talk to a person, بِسُنَّةٍ, and you tell him the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and then he says to you, دَعْنَا مِنْ هَذَا, don't tell us about the sunnah. Don't tell us about the sunnah that you're talking about. وَأَجِبْنَا عَنِ الْقُرْآنِ, if we ask you a question, just tell us the Qur'an. فَعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ ضَالٌ, know that this person is misguided. If a person says this to you, when you give him the sunnah and you give him a hadith and he says to you, don't tell us the ahadiths, we don't want this. What did he say? Know that this person is what? It's misguided. Now I'm going to mention the kalam of Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah that I promised that I was going to tell you, right? What does the ayah mean? وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Ibn Abdul Barr is explaining here what the ayah means. جَامِعُ بَيَانِ الْعِلْمِ وَفَضْلِهِ. Ibn Abdul Barr, he explains here for us, what does the sunnah do to the Quran? And what does the ayah mean? وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. What does it mean? Abu Umar Ibn Abdul Barr rahimahullah, he says, وَالْبَيَانُ مِنْهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ عَلَىٰ ضَرْبَيْنِ. The way that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he explains the Quran is in two ways. Are you with me, brothers? What does he do? In two ways he expands and he explains the Quran. Number one, بيان المجمل في الكتاب كبيانه للصلوات الخمس في مواقيتها وسجودها وركوعها وسائر أحكامها. There are some verses in the Quran which are ambiguous, that are unclear. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does he say? وأقيم الصلاة. What does Allah say? Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, wa aqimu as-salah. Establish the what? Establish the prayer. How? This is ambiguous. It's mujmal. You don't know how to pray. Okay? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told you, okay, you have to raise your hands, and he told you where you put your hand, and he sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us the ruku' and how straight your back is, and then the hands go up, and then where to, and then where your hands go, and then where you go. All of this he can. Which one comes first? The ruku' or the qiyam? Or the ruku' or the sujood? Or the tashawud or the sujood? He explained all of that to you. The Quran here is ambiguous. The sunnah, what did he do? Clarified it for you. That's the first type. The Quran has verses which are ambiguous. The sunnah comes and explains it for you. Ibn Abdul Barr says, this is the first one. The zakat, how much do you pay? It's also ambiguous. وَكَبَيَانِهِ لِمِقْدَارِ الزَّكَاةِ وَحَدِّهَا وَوَقْتِهَا. How much do you have to give? When do you have to give it? How do you give it? Who do you give it? It's all explained. وَمَا الَّذِي يُؤْخَذُ مِنْهُ مِنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَبَيَانِهِ لِمَنَاسِكِ الْحَجِّ. Hajj. How do you do Hajj? The Prophet ﷺ, he explained it to us when he said, خُذُوا عَنِّي مَنَاسِكَكُمْ. Take your Hajj from me. That's the first type. The second type is زِيَادَةٌ عَلَى حُكْمِ الْكِتَابِ. The sunnah is going to add on rulings that are not found in the Quran. Okay. This is the one that they don't like. Are you with me, brothers? This is the one that they hate. Which is what? The Quran comes with new rulings. Sorry, the Sunnah, sorry. The Sunnah, it comes with what? New rules that you will not find in what? You will not find in the Quran. Are you with me, brothers? It's not found in the Quran. It's only found in the Sunnah. Such as a man marrying a woman. كَتَحْرِيمِ نِكَاحِ الْمَرْأَةِ عَلَىٰ عَمَّتِهَا. Marrying a woman and her auntie. وَخَالَتِهَا. Her maternal and her paternal auntie. Her auntie from her, the girl's dad's side or her mother's side. Can you marry them at the same time? This is not found in the Quran. Are you with me, brothers? If can a person marry a woman and that woman's auntie and her maternal or paternal, amma and khala, can you marry all of them at the same time? No. Why? It's in the sunnah. Not in the ayah, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمْ أُمَّهَاتُكُمْ وَبَنَاتُكُمْ. It's not in there. All it prohibited in the ayah is وَأَن تَجْمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْأُخْتَيْنِ إِلَّا مَا قَدْ سَلَفْ. Two sisters. لكن عَمَّة and خَالَة, this is a حُكُم زِيَادَة, additional ruling found in the sunnah. Are you with me, brothers? Example he gives you, وَكَتَحْرِيمُ الْحُمْرِ الْأَهْلِيَةِ وَكُلُّ ذِينَابٍ مِنَ السِّبَعِ. Animals that have nails and claws. The prohibition is found in the sunnah. And it's not found in the Quran. إلى أشياء يطول ذكرها, Ibn Abdul Barr says. And many more other things, which there's, this is not the place to mention all of them. But this is an example. وقد أمر الله عز وجل بطاعات واتباع أمرا مطلقا مجملا لم يقيد بشيء ولم يقل ما وافق كتاب الله كما قال بعض أهل الزيغ. Here's powerful. Do we take the sunnah when it brings an additional ruling, brothers? Do we follow it? Do we submit to it? Yes. And anyone who says, I will follow the sunnah when it's in accordance to the Quran, this person is a sick-minded individual. Okay? We have now finished the first part today. I gave you Quran, I gave you sunnah, and I gave you some of the aqwal of the Salaf, right? The statement about you, Sakhtiyan, is from the Salaf. Are you with me, brothers? We've finished this point. Alhamdulillah. Accomplished. We were meant to go through Inayatu Salafi Biha. Lakin, ayah, should we go in? Hmm? Okay, let's go into inayatu salafi biha, the way that the salaf gave importance to the sunnah. Again, I'm going to touch on the sahabas, and I'm going to do it in two ways. How they followed it. Okay? How the sahabas, they followed it. Listen to the story, brothers. There's going to be stories, inshallah ta'ala, of how the sahabas were like following the sunnah. And wallahi, when we see this, from this minute onwards, brothers, we should be people like this. This is what we should work towards. If we're not there yet, our minds and our hearts should be towards this. We should be focusing on this, to work towards this. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he said, اتخذ النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خاتما من ذهب. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, he took a ring, a gold ring. Who took the gold ring? Nabiullah Muhammad. The Prophet took a gold ring and he started wearing it. فاتخذ الناس, the people also, the Prophet with a gold ring, what did they do? They, oh, gold ring. Because they love him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is their life. They love him, alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They copied him. They all bought a gold ring. فَاتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ خَوَاتِيمًا مِّنْ ذَهَبٍ فَقَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet then said, إِنِّي اتَّخَذْتُ خَاتِمًا مِّنْ ذَهَبٍ. Oh people, I took a golden ring. فَنَبَذَهُ. He took it off and he threw it. عليه الصلاة والسلام. Rid of it. When he did that, what did the people do? وَقَالَ. And the Prophet, when he threw it, he said, إِنِّي لَا أَلْبَسُهُ أَبَدًا. I'm never going to wear gold ever again. When he took it off, what did he say? I'm never going to wear gold again. فَنَبَذَ النَّاسُ خَوَاتِيمَهُمْ. Everyone took their ring off and he started throwing it. And guess what happened? The Prophet went and he bought what? A silver ring. And he put it on, everybody bought a silver ring. And they all started wearing it. And the Prophet ﷺ never took it off, and they never took it off. And when the Prophet ﷺ died, that ring got passed over to who? Huh? Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr used to use that ring because he said Muhammad Rasulullah on it. The Prophet used to use it as a, he used to use it as a stamp. When the Prophet died, Abu Bakr took it. And then when Abu Bakr died, Umar took it. And when Umar died, who took it? Uthman took it. And Uthman dropped it into a well. It fell into a well. And he requested for the well to be undug and for it. And the people went against Uthman radiallahu anhu, who rebelled against him. One of the things that they rebelled against him for was the ring. That is an evil man. The ring that was passed on by the Prophet to Abu Bakr, to Umar. Uthman took it and he threw it, it fell into a bi'r. This shows how evil this man is, that's what they said. You see? So Uthman requested for the whole world to be undug, everything to be brought out, for it to be found, but Allah did not will it, subhanahu wa ta'ala, it was not found. But this, what does it show us, brothers? Sahaba, ittiba'uhum biha, how they followed the sunnah. And the way they went quickly into it. Tirmidhi mentions in his Sunan that the Prophet's ring, some of the riwayat mention his right and some say his left. Both narrations have been transmitted. But the ring was inside. Do you get it? Inside. People's ring are upright. Huh? It sticks up like this. The Prophet was inside. His ring stuck inside, it was that way. Does that make sense?
He's wearing the ring like
a sunnah. La, it was sunnah al-aada. It's norms. Okay, it's not a... It's not a shari. Ah. But if the person's intending to follow the Prophet ﷺ because of love for him, that's another qadhi. We'll talk about these issues in more details elsewhere. Pay attention to this. Another example of how the sahabas used to follow the sunnah and how they were towards it. أبي سعيد الخضري رضي الله تعالى عنه يسأل قال بينما رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يصلي بأصحابه إذ قال أنا عليه. The Prophet ﷺ was wearing what? Shoes. He led the people with shoes on. Abu Dawud narrated this hadith, it's in his Sunan. The Prophet ﷺ what? He was wearing shoes. Alayhi salatu wasalam. And he was leading the people in his masjid. Not that I'm saying wear shoes inside the masjid. The only masjid that I've actually heard that they used to come in shoes with was Sheikh Muqbil ibn Hadi al-Waji'i's masjid. Students used to come in with their shoes. He would never stop them. If they wanted to, they can come in the masjid. In Yemen, Damaj, he would say to them, you can wear it. Anyone who wants it. And the carpet became destroyed because of that. But he felt that the sunnah was more valuable for the carpet. But I'm not saying to go into the masajid with your shoes on, okay? No way am I endorsing that. Because the harm that comes from it is greater. But the Prophet ﷺ led the salah with his shoes on, alayhi salatu wasalam. And when he led it, what did he do? إِذْ خَلَعَ عَلَيْهِ He took off his two shoes. فَوَضَعَهُمَا عَنْ يَسَارِ He put them on his left. He took them off in the salah. The sahabas were all looking at him. صلى الله عليه وسلم. فَلَمَّا رَآهُ ذَلِكَ الْقَوْمُ When the people saw him do that, أَلْقَوْ نِعَالَهُمْ All of them. Not one person. Every one of them in the middle of the salah, they took off their shoes, all of them, and they pushed it to the side, on their left side. فَلَمَّا قَضَى رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ صَلَاتَهُ So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he finished the prayer, he saw all of the companions, they're not wearing shoes anymore. And he said to them, مَا حَمَلَكُمْ عَلَىٰ إِلْقَائِكُمْ نِعَالَكُمْ What made you take off, all of you take off your shoes? Why did you all take your shoes off? فَقَالُوا They said, رَأَيْنَاكَ أَلْقَيْتَ نَعَلَيْكَ We saw you take your shoes off, O Messenger of Allah. فَأَلْقَيْنَا لِعَالَنَا We took off our shoes. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِنَّ جِبْرِيلَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ جِبْرِيلَ Atani, Jibril came to me, فَأَخْبَرَنِي أَنَّ فِيهِمَا قَذَرًا Jibril came to me in the salah and he told me that my shoes, they have filth on it. That's why I took mine off. Pay attention here. The way they followed him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abdullah ibn Abbas, another story. We'll stop it there. We'll go to the next point, which is, so we finish this one as well. We did this. We're now going to go into this one, inshallah, and we'll stop there, inshallah, ta'ala. Which is how the Sahabas would, first of all, they would gain the knowledge of the Sunnah. And I want to stop over this point, inshallah, ta'ala, and I want to extract benefits from it. Because I know a lot of you can relate to this hadith that I'm going to mention. A lot of you work. You probably have a 9-to-5 job. And maybe this is the only day in the week that you get the chance to study the deen. And you study the religion of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And the rest of the week you're busy and you're studying. Now what I want you to understand is you're not alone. You're not the only person who's felt this way. It's something that was present at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Sahabas, they couldn't all sit with the Prophet every single day. They had jobs. They had businesses. They had to make money. But they also wanted to take knowledge from him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the way that they used to do it was amazing. They wanted to learn that sunnah. Abdullah ibn Abbas mentioned this hadith is found in Sahih al-Bukhari. Okay, a lot of you are going to relate to this. Abdullah ibn Abbas, and he said, عن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه. Umar said, كنت أنا وجار لي من الأنصاري. Umar, where did he come from? Mecca, right? And remember when the Prophet ﷺ's companions came from Mecca and they came to Medina, what did the Prophet do? He made a Meccan with a Medinian, right? That's what he did. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, Umar radiallahu anhu said, Kuntu ana wa jaru li. I had a neighbor who was an Ansari. Me and him were the closest ones. Fi Bani Umayyah. Wa hiya min awali al-Madina. Wa kunna natanawabu an-nuzula. We both had a job. He worked and I worked. I had a job. So the way that we agreed was, one day I go to the Prophet, I don't go work, and I take knowledge from him. All the knowledge, all the hadiths, all the things that he says, everything that happens, I document it. And I come to you, and I tell you what I saw, and I tell you what I heard. And you do the same the next day, and I go work. Are you with me, brothers? So we used to do that. Yanzilu yawman, one day he would come to the Prophet. Wa anzilu yawman, and one day I will come to the Prophet. Fa'idha nazaltu ji'tu bi khabari dhalika al-yawmi min al-wahyi wa ghayri. Any revelation that came down, any hadith, anything, I will tell him. Wa idha nazala, if he came, fa'ala mithlu dhalika. The Sahabas were busy. But look how they saw it important that they what, brothers? That they nurture themselves. وَلِذَلِكَ you're a component of three things. You have a body, you have a mind, and you have a soul. Are you with me, brothers? A lot of people, when they just think about their jobs and the money that they need to make, they're only worrying about their body. Really, the money that you're making, what do you want to do? Just want to be big, strong. Food, that's what it does for you, right? Break down the reason why you work. Why do you work for? You want to provide, you want to eat, that's it. Salah. But the only thing that you focused on is the body. What about the mind and the soul? So the Sahabas realized that it is vital for you to take care of your body, to eat, to make money for your family and for yourself. But they also realized that the revelation is the only thing that can nurture the mind and the soul. That's why Allah said, وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِّنْ أَمْرِنَا مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانِ وَلَكِنْ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُورًا نَهْدِي بِهِ مَنْ نَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا وَإِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. Allah said, وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ روح. Allah referred to the revelation as a what? Ruh. Are you with me, brothers? Why? And gives life to the soul. Are you with me, brothers? As for the Quran, nurturing the mind, Allah, how many places does He say in the Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِمْ عِبْرَةً لِؤُلِي الْأَلْبَابِ مَا كَانَ حَدِيثًا يُفْتَرَى وَلَكِنْ تَصْدِيقَ الَّذِي بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ وَتَفْصِيلَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَهُدًا وَرَحْمَةً لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. Many places in the Quran, if you look at, Allah says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَذَكَّرُونَ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعَقِلُونَ. Quran is talking to the mind. Are you with me, brothers? We'll stop here, inshallah ta'ala. Even this one we haven't started yet. Like, we'll stop there. Next week we'll carry on this issue of at-tahari wa at-tathabbuti fi ma yarunahu. And we mentioned the tabi'een and the next lesson, inshallah ta'ala. Bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruku wa atubu ilayh. Was there a lot of information today? Yeah? A lot of information? Inshallah. Just watch the video maybe 20 times. The references were mentioned in the notes, so you can just look at the ayats, it's there. At least, you know those verses? At least memorize three of them. There's six, memorize at least three. The hadiths, at least memorize three. And the aqwal salaf, at least memorize one or two. Because this is important. That you can talk evidences, the position of the sunnah. Okay, any questions? Fadal. Okay, if the person does reject the sunnah and they say we don't accept the sunnah and that's how they were born and their forefathers were like that, then la shakka wa la raib, they were never Muslims. Rejecting the sunnah is not Islam. You're not a Muslim. Are you with me, brothers? But if the person is a Muslim or was a Muslim and then they say, I don't believe in the sunnah, then this individual leaves the fold of Islam. He will leave that statement, will take him out of the fold of Islam. Is the proof established against him or is it not? There's a mawtin al khilaf. It's a dispute amongst the scholars. I'm of the opinion, he leaves the religion even before the evidence is established on him. Before it's even established on him. But the evidence has to be brought to him to be brought back to the religion. Okay? It's a very dangerous statement. Because when you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, sah? And then what's the next part? Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, this is what it is, following the sunnah, right? Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah is missing. If a person doesn't come with Ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah, what do they come with? They haven't come with the shahadatain that makes them a Muslim. Now, pay attention. If a person rejects a particular hadith, I don't believe this hadith. Or a person says, you know what? I don't believe in Sahih al-Bukhari. مثلاً. This is bid'ah, dalal, misguidance. Doesn't take them out of the fold of Islam. Are you with me? We're talking about a person who says, I don't take sunnah at all. That's what we're talking about, okay? Shall I tell you the best way to deal with them? Make sure you come to this course from the beginning to the end. The truth is, we're going to be tackling all of those points. The arguments. How is hadith gathered? The Prophet ﷺ didn't even know these things. He didn't even accept the authentication. He didn't even accept the writing of hadith. And etc. And their doubts. Every single point that they brought, we will what? We will respond to it, inshallah ta'ala. But the way we respond to it is, I won't tell you there's a doubt that's out there and they say this. I'll just make it all into a what? Just a lesson. Okay? I'll just make sure that the points and the answers, that's it. But after you finish this, are you with me, brothers? You realize. Wallahi, I'll tell you something. Just the other day I was talking to somebody about Sahih al-Bukhari. And he goes, Sahih al-Bukhari, did even Imam al-Bukhari write this? Is it even his? How do you know? I said to him, who narrated Sahih al-Bukhari from Imam al-Bukhari? Do you know? No. He didn't. Why do I even need to know? It's not even important. So you don't know? No. 90,000 people heard Bukhari from him, Sahih. How many people? 90,000 people heard Bukhari from him. His kitab al-jami' al-musnad al-mukhtasar al-sahih min sunan al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa ayyami. Lakin it became famous and common from the student Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Farabri. Al-Farabri, however you want to say it. From Muhammad ibn Yusuf al-Farabri, 13 people heard it from him. How many people? 13 people, but it became famous from 3 people. Al-Kushmayhani, Ibn Hamuyat al-Saraqsi, Al-Mustamli, Ibn Hamuyat al-Saraqsi, and Al-Kushmayhani. Both 3 of them, Abi Dharr al-Harawi narrated it from, and Abi Dharr al-Harawi's narration is the one Hafidh al-Hajar relies on Fathul Bari. When you look at Fath al-Bari, it's the riwayah of Idhar al-Harawi an mashayikhihi thalatha, from his 3 teachers. An mashayikhihi al-thalatha. There's another riwayah called riwayatu Abi Ishaq, riwayatu Ibrahim ibn Ma'qal al-Nasafi. Khattabi uses that one in his kitab I'lam al-Hadith and I'lam al-Sunan. Are you with me, brothers? I asked him, do you know any of this? He goes, wallahi, I don't. I asked him, do you know the conditions of Bukhari in his Sahih? What is Sahih to him? Like, this book you have to understand. And Imam al-Iraqi says in his Alfiya, وأول من صنف في الصحيح محمد وخص بالترجيح ومسلم بعد وبعض الغرب مع أبي علي فضلوا ذا لو نفع ولم يعماه ولكن قلما عند ابن أخرم منه قد فاتهما ورد لكن قال يحيى البر لم يفوت الخمسة إلا النزر وفيه ما فيه لقول الجعفي أحفظ منه عشر ألف ألف. Bukhari's kitab is the most authentic book any human being has ever written. على وجه الأرض. Any human, whichever religion they attribute themselves to, there is not a book more authentic than this book. Never was and never has been. على الإطلاق. تلقته الأمة بالقبول. Are you with me, brothers? So when you see somebody opening doubt on Sahih al-Bukhari, and Imam al-Bukhari is Sahih, don't ever think to yourself that they really intend Bukhari Sahih. But they really intend the what? As-Sunnah. Get rid of Bukhari, because this is the most authentic book to you. Are you with me, brothers? How many years was Bukhari writing in Sahih for? 16 years. And then when he wrote his book for 16 years, Ibn Hajar, after studying Sahih al-Bukhari, it took him 16 years, Ibn Hajar, to write an introduction for Sahih al-Bukhari before he wrote his Fathul Bari. 16 years he was writing Hadyusari, which is an introduction to Sahih al-Bukhari. Talking about what? The conditions of Bukhari and the manhaj and the methodology of Bukhari in his Sahih and who narrated it from him and the tarajim, the chapters in Bukhari and the mu'allaqat in Bukhari and the alaqa between the tarjama and the hadith and the relationship between the two. Ibn Hajar, it took him how many years? 16 years. Are you with me, brothers? So to easily come and say that Sahih al-Bukhari, it's not authentically transmitted to Imam al-Bukhari, and also Bukhari has ahadith which are wahiya, da'ifa, like that. Na'am, there are some scholars who criticize some ahadith, some wordings in what? In Sahih al-Bukhari, like Imam al-Darqutni, Abu Mas'ud al-Dimashqi, Abu Ali al-Jayyani and others, they criticize it. The author of the kitab Taqeed al-Muhmal. Yes, they did criticize it, but they didn't do it based on desires. They done it by following the science of hadith. Are you with me, brothers? By following the what? The science of hadith. Not because this goes against my logic. Are you with me, brothers? Or this goes against my critical thinking. So based on that, I don't accept this book, Sahih al-Bukhari. No, these scholars, they follow their science. Bukhari, when he wrote his Sahih, do you know what he did? He placed his Sahih in front of who? He finished his book, authored it. He took it to Yahya ibn Ma'in. He took it to Ali ibn Madini. He took it to Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Are you with me, brothers? And they looked at his book and they only criticized four hadiths. There's 4,000 something hadiths in there. They criticized four hadiths. And you know what Abu Ja'far al-Uqayli said? Ja'far al-Uqayli, he said, وَالْقَوْلُ قَوْلُ ibn al-Bukhari. Even those four, Bukhari was right. Even the criticism of those four, he's right. Anyways, the point is, wallahi, I'm telling you, brothers, when you take time out to study the science of hadith, wallahi, you appreciate what these scholars did for us and the effort that these individuals exerted and the hard work that these people put in. Al-Imam al-Bukhari is a madrasa. He's a madrasa. What is he? If universities came together and they tried to look into the works of Bukhari and they tried to do tatabbu' and following his up, wallahi, they would get tired. Are you with me, brothers? Do you know how many sharah Sahih al-Bukhari has? 300 sharah. How many? 300 sharah. Al-Kirmani, Al-Qastalani, Bukha ibn Hajar, Badruddin al-Ayni, Ibn Rajab al-Hanbali, Suyuti has a sharh on it, Khattabi, Abu Sulaiman al-Khattabi, I by myself, only me alone, I have 80 different sharah. Ibn Mulaqin sharah, 80. Imagine 300. Can you finish 300 and take benefits from all of them? Are you with me, brothers? May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala allow us. والذين جاءوا من بعدهم يقولون ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان. You see, nowadays what died out, brothers, is respecting those who came before us and honoring those who came before us. I mean, wallah, when you look at the scholars, they always respected those who came before them. They respected them. Even they were so respectful, even they respected their students. Are you with me? Look at Ibn Malik, his Alfiyah. He says, وَلَا يَجُوزُ الْإِبْتِدَاءُ وَلَا يَجُوزُ وَلَا يَجُوزُ وَلَا يَجُوزُ فِي وَلَا يَجُوزُ الْإِبْتِدَاءُ بِالنَّكِرَةِ مَا لَمْ يُفِدْكَ عِنْدَ زَيْدِ النَّمِرَةِ وَهَلْ فَتَنْفِيكُمْ فَمَا خِلٌّ لَنَا وَرَجُلٌ مِنَ الْكِرَامِ عِنْدَنَا. Ibn Malik said, وَرَجُلٌ مِنَ الْكِرَامِ عِنْدَنَا. He's talking about Nawawi. Nawawi is a student of Ibn Malik. He mentions a mas'ala. Are you with me, brothers? A view that he holds, Ibn Malik, and a discussion regarding it. And then he says, but there's somebody who opposes us in this issue. And he's talking about his own student, Imam al-Nawawi. And at the beginning, he talks about the sheikh before him that authored in grammar. He's respecting him. قال محمد هو ابن مالك أحمد رب الله خير مالك مصليا على النبي المصطفى وآله المستكملين الشرفا وأستعين الله في ألفية مقاصد النحو بها محوية تقرب الأقصى بلفظ موجز وتبسط البذل بوعد منجز وتقتضي رضا بغير السخط فائقة ألفية ابن معطي وهو بسبق حائز تفضيلا مستوجب ثنائي الجميلة والله يقضي بهبات وافرة لي وله في درجات الآخرة. He's a scholar who came before him. He wrote 1,000 lines in grammar and he's saying, may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala honor him. He came before me, he's more virtuous. وَالَّذِينَ جَاءُوا مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا وَلِإِخْوَانِينَ الَّذِينَ سَبَقُونَا بِالْإِيمَانِ. That was a long tangent I went off onto. And we're going to start the next lesson, inshallah ta'ala.